Savior came from glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. And I repented of my sin and won that victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing fire revealing. How he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me that victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he brought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath that cleansing blood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. How he made the lamp the streets of gold beyond that crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there that song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Ethan, good job, buddy. Good job. I guess we'll let the little guys get downstairs. And I think Sandy's going down there with them. I hope she is anyway. I didn't get to speak to her since I've been here this morning. There ain't nobody down there. We'll be down there in a minute. but anyways, I sure enjoy teaching the youth of this church. It's quite an honor for me. But it's also a privilege to stand here today and be able to give this message. You know, I preached a funeral last week on last Thursday, and as I was praying about what God would want me to give to that congregation, those group of people that was there, I had already had this message in mind when Pastor had asked me to speak, so I was working on it. So I said, I'm just going to ask them about where they are in their faith. Are they running this race of faith in this life? Are we just running? Are we just here? Our scripture reading today will come from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. But just a real quick introduction to this, where this is going. The very first word in that chapter 12 starts out, it says, therefore. And the question always is, well, what's therefore? So you got to look back what was said before. So chapter 11 is known, what we know as, some people call it the Old Testament Saints Hall of Fame. Heroes of the Faith. It's been called many different things because it's what we know as the faith chapter in the Bible. And that's chapter 11 of Hebrews. But what it goes on to talk was about the faith of all these people, Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, and so on, Moses, and all these Old Testament saints who had kept the faith looking towards the cross. Because you have to understand, Christ hadn't come yet. So these guys were in great faith. You know, Abraham left Ur of the Chaldeans in a place that God told him to go to this promised land. And it was by faith that he went to this place. But it was also by faith that they were knowing they were going to receive a greater reward someday. And as I always say, they were looking to the cross. We have the benefit of God's word of looking back at the cross. And that's it's been such a blessing in my life. I can't say enough of it for it. But in this chapter 12, when it starts out, it uses a metaphor of a runner. And as this running this race of faith, as the writer is speaking here, he's saying running this race of faith is like running a race. And back then, they had the Olympiads or whatever, or I can't remember what they were all called at that time, but running was a big thing. So the writer in Hebrews here is using running as this metaphor of running this race of faith. We have to understand also that the writer of Hebrews was talking to these Jews of that time who were caught up in what we've known as Judaism. In other words, they were hung up in the law. They didn't want to believe that Jesus had come and died on the cross for our sins. They were hung up in keeping all these Old Testament religious laws. And the writer in Hebrews is saying, no, you got to throw off all those things. And Terrence has so graciously come to be with me today. And some of you through in the hand of fellowship, I know we're looking at him thinking, boy, he come dressed for the occasion today. Probably think, Terrence, I'm going to ask you to come up here. Because for those of you who don't know, Terrence was a runner in school. And he's a really good runner. Actually, second in state. But Terrence, I asked him if he would help me with this because he knows what it is to run this race of athletics. So I've asked him today because in this very first verse, and let me just read these three verses and then we'll go on from there. It says, therefore, since we have been surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, speaking of those Old Testament saints in chapter 11, he said, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance this race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer, and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, considering him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So the writer's saying, we're using this metaphor of running, and it says the very first thing, it says, throw off everything that so easily hinders your faith. So using this metaphor of the runner, Terrence wouldn't set out to run the race in this. This is a warm-up suit. This is something that the runner would put on to prepare himself to get ready to run. And I asked him, I said, to get down and show, because, go ahead, Terrence, you can get down. And he's going to look how it would be like to start running this race, because it would be silly to think that we could run this race and I would put on something like this to run a race. And then Terrence would be like that. The Bible's saying throw off anything that would hinder you from running this race. It would look so silly for me to be in a starting line with a guy like this and want to run this race. And that's the same way it is. It's silly to think that we can live our lives any old way we want to and be in this run of faith, this race of faith. God's saying you can't do it. You got to throw off all those things that hinder you, all this sin that so easily entangles you, things that are keeping you from coming to church on Sunday, things that are just binding us up each and every day and not allowing us to walk the way God's called us to walk. He says, get rid of all that stuff. Throw it away. Get rid of it. Terrence, I'm going to send you on your race. You can go run your race. So, thank you, Terrence. So in using this metaphor, And knowing that he's running this race and he's taken off on this journey, in our lives as Christians, as we start to run this race, we've gotten rid of the sin, anything that entangles us. And when we think of the word entangles, it's not talking about sin. It could be a relationship Well, I don't go to church because my girlfriend don't want me to go, or my husband don't want me to go, or whatever. That's something that's keeping you from doing, running your race. It could be your children. I can't get my kids up to go, so we just didn't come today. That's bad. It could be, man, we talk about this in this church a lot, especially me being in youth ministry, the sports. It could be something that's tying you up from running your race. This race of faith that God's called us to do. It could be many things that are hindering from doing this run. One thing, and so you might, in my message today, I've asked, these are the questions I'm going to be asking is how, when, where, and why. So the first question the runner would ask is, how am I going to run this race? First, he's going to train. He's going to get himself ready. That's how we, as the Christians, prepare for this run of this race of faith. It says faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the Word of God. How do you hear? How do we hear the Word of God? You got to come to church. If you're going to run a race, you got to come to church. Listen to the good radio stations that are putting out. I love listening to Joy FM. Get a lot of my ministry stuff that I pick up there from it. Listen to the good music. Listen to the preachers who are sounding the doctrine of faith, that are preaching the good news, not preaching a salvation by works or that you can earn your way into heaven. Come and get in the wholesome preaching that you're needing. That's how you prepare for this race. Because in 2 Timothy 3:16 it says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful in teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So if you're going to run this race, that's training you. As it says, that passage of scripture says, it will teach you, it will rebuke you, it will correct you, and it will train you. In teaching, teaches us how to walk this life. Rebuking you, when you step off that trail or off that path running this race, God says, I'm going to rebuke you. But he also says, I will correct you. In correcting you, he says, I'm going to put you back on the right path. If you'll read my word and you'll allow me to do it, he said, then we'll train you back up to be this faithful servant that I've called you to be. That's running a race of faith. That's how we start to run this race. You know, it says without faith, it's impossible to please God. How can you have it? If you ain't got faith, how can you please God? There's no way. I spoke about that downstairs this morning. Without your faith, how are you going to please God? And I heard a pastor on the radio this week as I was listening to a ministry. He said something I thought was really neat. He said, if there's no root, there's no fruit. No root, no fruit. I thought that was really good. Butch is a gardener. As a matter of fact, I seen that as he went to dinner last night. He had his garden plowed up. If you don't plant the seed in the soil, it's not going to grow. It's not going to produce any fruit. And God says, I will know them. Jesus said, I will know them by their fruit. Training, getting ready is how we become in the race, how we get in the race. And then the runner might ask, well, when do I start the race? Of course, if you're going to run a race, you need to know when it starts. So in Romans 10:9, it says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Your race has started. The moment you say, God, I'm a sinner. I can't do this no more on my own. I need you to come into my heart and save me. I confess my sins to you. I want to be the man of God you called me. I want to run this race of faith. The moment you say that, your race has started. It started. And you got to get ready. You got to be trained. You got to be ready for that time to come. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you have to change your whole way of thinking. As I spoke to this officer the other day that I had the honor of speaking to, me and him were talking about some different issues. And I told him, you know, in my life, and a lot of you guys know my story here. In my life, it was a total transformation of my way of thinking. And that's the way it is with each and every one of you. And it tells us in the Word of God. When I read that verse in the Bible a long time ago, it stuck with me. It says, go to the next one, Andy. It says, do not conform to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Guys, we can't do it on our own. And to think that you can quit just doing something that's hindering you from running your race or training you up for this race, you can't do it on your own. You got to transform your mind with the power of the Holy Spirit in praying, reading your scriptures, doing the will of God. And if you'll submit yourself to Him, God will train you. I hear so many times people say, I'm reading the Bible, Duke, but it ain't doing nothing for me. I ain't understanding it. Read it again. Don't give up. I told a story about me giving my daughter one time a brand new cell phone. Week before that, I asked her if she's reading her Bible. No, I don't understand it. Before I gave her that new cell phone, I went to hand it to her. I pulled it back and I said, are you going to know how to work this phone when I give it to you? And she goes, no, I have to play with it and figure it out. I said, do that with your Bible. Play with it and figure it out. If you can do that with a phone, why can't you do that with your Bible? We seem to have our minds conformed to the things of this world and not to the things of God. Seems like God's always getting put on the back burner. And that's not what He desires for us when we're running this race of faith. You know, I've always, when I looked at this passage of Scripture, as I read on down, it said, let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. That word perseverance, and this is one of the most well-known verses in the Bible that we hear all the time. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Annie, if I'm correct, is that your favorite verse in the Bible? Is it yours? That's Annie's. And it's rightly so, it should be one of them. Because that's what it is. I can't do it on my own. I don't have the strength. But the Holy Spirit does. God does. Jesus does. If I'll ask Him to come in, help me run this race. Because I can't do it, God. I can't do it on my own. Help me to get me through where I am and where I can be, where I can be the servant that You've called me to be. Then the next thing I got up here is a runner wants to know the conditions. I know Brother Jack went to other states and ran. And I think he told me he got there and the hills were up and down. You have to train for that. These runners, whenever they get to run, they have to train. They have to know where this is going to be run. I got a friend of mine who actually is my boss and a good friend, Kelly Krieger. He goes out to Arizona. It's not like running here in Missouri. The air is different. When I was in Colorado, I didn't realize that, but that's where the Olympic Training Center is. And the reason it's there, it's in a higher elevation because they get their complete endurance up there because it makes them breathe harder and stronger. In other words, the guy's getting stronger. So they want to know where we're running this race. You know, and as I read this passage of Scripture, it says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, for the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning the shame. You know, Jesus' course was paved to the way of the cross. It led Him straight to the cross. That's where He ran the race for us. And in leading Him to the cross, He saved many, many, many people. Because when you read that passage of Scripture, it said the joy set before Him. Do you think Jesus seen any joy looking at the cross? He did, in a way. But He didn't in another way. Do you remember when He was sitting in the praying the night before He went to the cross? It said that Jesus was on it saying, Father, if You can't, take this cup from Me. But if You can't, let Thy will be done. Let Thy will be done. I thought that was so odd because He said he was pleading so hard that blood was actually coming through His sweat and His tears, that the anguish that He was facing. But still, He seen joy in running that race. I've seen it in the face. I've talked about this morning. You know, how can we think there's joy, Duke, in the death? How can there be joy in death? I've ministered at funerals of a dear lady here a while back. Everybody in there was just as happy and talking and praising God. And I thought, that's the joy. Amen. These people ain't grieving like the heathen does. They knew where their loved one was at. They knew she was in heaven. Amen. That's the joy. And Jesus seen that knowing that those who believe and trust in Him and are running this race of faith, they could come and share in that joy and be at the right hand of the Father just as He is. Notice it says He sat down at the right hand of the Father. You know why He sat down? He wouldn't run that race anymore. He's done. Jesus said on the cross, it's finished. I finished it for you. Now, are you going to join the race? Or are you just going to sit on the side and just watch it go by? It's not an easy race. So, for us as the Christians, when we're asked, where do I run my race, Duke? Where am I going to run my race? Matthew 28:19 Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. You say, well, Duke, I'm not a preacher. I wasn't. Don't know if I'm still one, but I know it's what God's called me to do. But do you have loved ones? I know we do. I got a whole stack full of cards right there, loved ones. Right there that we placed on the altar. You can minister to them. You're running your race. You're asking God, God, give me the knowledge, give me the wisdom through your word that I can minister to these people. You have coworkers. I run across people each and every day that I'm able to witness to. Maybe you don't have to give them the full gospel right then, but you can ask them to come to church. Guys, that's the easiest way to witness. You can teach your children. We can read the Bible with them. That's training. That's teaching. That's running the race. That's where we run the race. It could be in our own home trying to reach somebody for Christ. I struggle with it in my own family. I don't have none of my kids here today. I don't have my mother and father here today, and they're all alive and well. But they choose to live in the world. But I still pray for them. I still ask God to give them mercy until they can be brought into an understanding of Him. That's where we're running our race. You're running your race right now. And when you're praying and asking to minister to people, God will open those doors for you. God's not going to send you in any situation He can't help you get through. Never be ashamed to tell someone about Christ. Never be ashamed to tell anybody about the gospel. If somebody asks you, why do you go to church? You tell them because Jesus died for me on that cross, and I owe it to Him. That's why you tell them. You don't have to go in and tell them, well, it started back in Adam and Eve. You don't have to give them the whole Bible. Just give them a little bit. Just give them a little bit, the taste of it. Also, as I've mentioned many times, you might be the only Bible anybody ever reads. You walk in that faith. You run in that faith. You stay in the faith. Let God help support you in growing in that faith to minister the Word of God to those who don't know. That's what our job is, to make disciples. Romans 1:16 says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it is the power of God to bring salvation to everyone who believes. That's the power. We just watched a movie last week downstairs about that young lady in Columbine who gave the ultimate price. Before the gunman put the gun to her head, he asked her, do you believe in God? She said, yes, you know I do. He says, you're going to meet Him. And he killed her. She paid the ultimate sacrifice. But she lived her life before that being ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Afraid of her boyfriend to find out she was a Christian and wouldn't want nothing to do with her no more. She was ashamed of it. Once she came, the name of the movie is called I'm Not Ashamed. Once she realized that she was putting Christ down, she says, I'm not doing it no more. I'm putting my life for Him. I'm living it. I'm not going to be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. But it cost her life. But she won. She won. As you go on and think about this, it says, so why? Why am I running this race? What is so important about it? As that passage of scripture I got up there, I'm just going to back up real quick here, because the runner receives a reward. Okay? He receives a reward. And Jack, again, I know Jack has run them and run those races, and then several other people I think in here have ran them. You receive a crown. And I remember going to Jack's house when I was a kid, when we were kids hanging out. You had a trophy case over there because he had two brothers, other brothers, that they had all tons of trophies. I just had a few at my house. But you know what? I don't know where none of them are. Jack, I don't know. Do you have any in your house? Yeah. Brother Jack says, no, he don't know. They have a bunch of them. I don't know how many they have. They have a bunch. My stepson, Josh. I went out to my garage when I got home from prison. That whole garage is full of motocross trophies. Josh, you got any of those trophies? He ain't got none of those trophies. Why? Because they're temporary. They perish with time. I'm going to ask Terrence to come back in. Terrence, if you come back in here real quickly. Terrence has been running this race for us. As you can see, he's a little skinned up now. Got a little blood on his knees. His number's not looking so good. because he's been running the race. When you run a race, it's grueling. There's so many ministries out there preaching right now that when you become a Christian, your life's going to be all good. It's all good. You ain't got to worry about nothing else. You ain't going to have no more troubles or nothing. Not if you're running your race right. Terrence looks like he's been running the race because he's come back all ragged. He's tired. He's exhausted. He's wore out. It's because he's been running this race. You know one thing he does, sometimes we can take and hand him a trophy, give him a little medal. His eyes light up, and man, he's all good. For how long? For how long? So he can find another race to win another trophy or maybe get the big check. But it perishes. It has no value to it whatsoever except for what you got for the moment. Parents, thank you again, buddy. I appreciate your help today. Thank you. But the Bible says, as I said, it mentioned that passage of Scripture. It says, do you not know that in a race, all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way to get the prize. They run in such a way to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. That's what they do. They run this race receiving something that ain't going to last. It has no meaning. But God says, as you notice, I didn't read the last part of that verse. We do it to receive a crown that will last forever. Ain't that awesome? That I know that I run this race, and I wonder why. Why is people getting sick around me? Why are people dying around me? God, why don't you do something? Why don't you come in and take care of all these marriage problems, all these children problems that we're having, loss of jobs? Yeah, even death can be the big one. Why, God? Why not? And one thing I wrote down here was, I'm sure the Apostle Paul at times might have thought, why? Why am I running this race? God, it seems like everybody's against me. In the Scriptures, we know that Paul was shipwrecked, I think three times, I don't know, several times in the Bible, shipwrecked. He was beaten. He was stoned almost to the point of death, abandoned by his own people who ran from him. They seen Paul as being persecuted and even imprisoned. You think Paul ever said, God, why? Why am I running this race? It ain't getting me nowhere. You know, when trouble comes, and not if, not when, it's when. It's not if trouble comes, it's when trouble comes, and it's going to when you're running this race in this Christian life. It should bring us back to the author and perfecter of our faith, that being Jesus Christ. He's ran the race perfect. We're not all going to be illnesses and, you know, the effects of everyday life. We're going to continue to struggle with those things, but we still put our faith in Jesus Christ and what Jesus has for us. There's a new song out by Mercy Me called Even If. It says, I know the sorrow and I know the pain. The hurt would all go away if you just say the word. But even if you don't, my hope's in you alone. No matter what I'm struggling through, no matter what I'm going through, God, I can take it. You've given me the perseverance to run this race, to run it wholeheartedly, if I put my faith and trust in you. So are you running the race? That's my question to the congregation today. Are you running a race, or are we just sitting there watching it go by, as I mentioned earlier? Are we putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ? Or are we putting our faith and trust in individuals and other things? The other question I ask today is, those for us who are running it, is it worth it? Is it worth all the ridicule that we take, all the disobedience that you might not think about it, but sometimes I feel like I'm getting knocked down by my own family because I can't get them into understanding. Brother Jack was praying this morning. We were talking about that. You know, there ain't nothing that hurts us than trying to draw one of our own family members to the Lord. So is it worth it for me? You know, I'd like to ask Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, if I was able to, was it worth it? Was it worth it leaving Ur of the Chaldeans and being led in this other promised land, fighting all the battles and everything you did? Was it worth it? That's the question I ask today. I'd like to ask Joseph. Joseph was one, he was sought to be one who was going to be above his brothers and everything, and they sold him into slavery. He was thrown in prison in Egypt due to Potiphar's wife trying to seduce him. I'd like to ask Joseph, was it all worth it? You know, and the many other things I got written on this paper was Moses led him out of Egypt and never entered the promised land. Joshua, all those I would like to ask, was it worth it? Did you run your race in vain? Was it worthless? Or is you running it because you received a prize? Because we're all running a race. I could ask my mother-in-law right now. She's been battling cancer, heart attacks, all that stuff. But I've watched her grow in the Lord these last few years, reading her Bible, coming to church. Mom, is it worth it? Brother Bob, I ask you, is it worth it? Jack? Brother Mark? Sister Annie? Cricket? Brother Tony? Velma? Butch? Joanne? Is it worth it, guys? I think it is. I could ask Dane, Angel, Joe and Gina, all you guys. I'm going to ask the congregation, guys, is it worth it running this race of faith? Yes. Is it worth it? You know, I could probably call Brother Hugh and Sister Eunice right now. Brother Hugh ministering for all the years he did. Now he's kind of just laid up, but he's still in good spirits. And Eunice, all the things that she's been going through, I would like to call her today and ask her, Eunice, is it worth it? I know what she would say. Worth every bit of it. She told me the other day that when they found that mass on her heart, even if it was cancer, she found out that her kids were praying for her. And she said, that's what I have to do. If I have to die to bring my kids to Jesus Christ, I'm willing to do it. God bless her for that. She knows it's worth it. And I'm here today to testify to it because I know what I've done in my life. Everything that I've put myself through and my family through. But I know because I read my scriptures and I know the promises that God has for me. And I'm here to testify today to tell you it's worth it. It's worth it, guys. If you'll get in the race, you'll run this race of faith and you'll be faithful to God, reading His Word, ministering to others, God will be faithful to you. Trust me, I know it's real. I've seen it work in the lives of many individuals. And it's real. So in closing, if you're not running the race, what's stopping you? Is it pride? Is it your own self-determination? I don't know. Only you know that. God says, I've made it available for you. Are you going to take hold of it? It's easy. When I said a while ago, it says all you got to do is confess, Romans 10:9. Confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead. You will be saved. It's as easy as that. I say it's as easy as that to receive it, but then the race starts and it becomes difficult because there's going to be everybody trying to knock you down because they ain't going to like what you become. But are you here to please men or are you here to please God? I'm here to please God. I don't care what man thinks about me. So, are you running a race? That's the question I ask. So, as a song of invitation is getting ready to be played, this altar is always open. Each and every Sunday, we ask those to come. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, or if you're here today and think, man, maybe I ain't been running my race quite the way I have. I need to be. I ain't doing it right, Duke. You can come forward. Remember what I said, not being ashamed? Why is it so hard for us to come to the altar? Why is it so hard to walk up here, get on our knees, and say, God, I blew it. I'm not worthy. I'm asking you to come in my heart and receive you, and receive me, receive you as my Lord and Savior, and to do your will in my life, to be obedient to your word to the best of my abilities, knowing that you have something better for me. That's so easy to do. But why is it so hard? I don't know. Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you in prayer, we just thank you for this time we got to spend together. Thank you for this beautiful church, this body of believers that come each and every week. Father, we pray that if we're not running this race and not running it correctly, we know that you said that you will put us back, you will correct us, you will straighten us out and get us on the right path. We're leaning on you for that. We pray for all those within our families, as we've spoken about so much today, about those who don't know you as Lord and Savior, that you would work in the hearts and lives of these individuals. Some of them are precious to us, and some of them might be a total stranger or a co-worker. We just ask you to work in their lives. We thank you for this, again, for this group of people. We thank you for our pastor who's gone. We just pray for their safe return, and just continue to bless this church, Father, as we serve you. We praise you, O Lord, and it's in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. So the altar's open. If anybody wants to come as Lynn sings this song, feel free to come up. And it's not just a place of salvation. It's a place, if you got something going on, ask Jesus to come in and help you get through it, because he will. Okay? Once again, for everybody being here, thank our visitors for being here today. And I'm going to ask Darren now, I guess, to come and we'll take up the offering. But once again, guys, it's always a privilege of mine to come and give you the word today. So thank you. Thank you.
song and with scripture. Lord, we just ask the blessing upon each and every one of these Sunday school teachers who have set the time and effort in the day to teach not only the youth but the adults. What a wonderful message for Mother Duke today. And we do need to ask ourselves, are we running the race? And if we are, why aren't we? Lord, we just ask that you would just bless us all, pray for the kingdom. Lord, we just thank you and love you and praise you.